It looks a little different today, but we are so glad to have you all with us. Would you stand as we just begin our time of praise and worship this morning? Once again, welcome to First Christian Church. Hopefully you were able to take a sneak peek at the sanctuary as you came by. It's coming along great, looking great. I'm very excited. I hope every one of you are too. And as you came in, I hope you grabbed a bulletin. It's got a lot of information in it for this upcoming week. Remember, tonight's a pajama party. So if you haven't bought pajamas, that's all right. Wear what you have. Come on to the house at 6 o'clock. If you don't have a present, grab something from your house and wrap it up and bring that. If you don't have food, don't worry. We're going to have plenty. So just come on out at 6 o'clock for the pajama party tonight. Yes. Okay. Perfect. So no excuses, people. All right. Jillian's going to be at the church at 5:40. If you think that you can't drive out, that's okay. She will bring you. So see, she probably will. So just show up at 5:40, okay? So, thank you, Jillian. Also in the bulletin, like I said, lots of information. The all-church Christmas caroling will be December 12th. That is next week. Join us here at 3:45 for a hayrack ride over to the Pioneer Manor. They will also be stopping by some church families, I guess, on the way. So come help out with that. That's fun. Show choir will try to be there to help you. We'll be coming from another performance, but we'll try to be there to do that as well. Also, next week will be the white gift offering, along with the Christmas bread, so it's a big day. That means that Sunday school will take place either here at the sanctuary, where we're having church next week. Sunday school will be there. We will do the white gift offering. Then we will have the Christmas bread. So everybody bring your favorite Christmas bread, Christmas breakfast item, and we'll fellowship together that way next week. We also have the annual church meeting on December 12th. So the absentee ballots are on the Welcome Center, actually back here. So, and then the budget. So if you'd like to take a look at that, you may pick those up here in the sanctuary today so that we can be looking at that for the annual meeting. Also, the kids program, which I'm so excited to come watch, will be on the 19th at 10:30. So you don't want to miss that. That is always kind of a highlight of my year to be able to watch that and just watch the kiddos. And so be sure and be here for that program as well. Are there any other announcements that we've missed today? On the 19th for the kids program, I hear there's going to be, or I'm told that there will be camels here. So you don't want to miss that, whatever that means. I don't know. Okay, so I will be here to check that out for sure. So are there any other announcements? It is Lori's birthday, yes. Should we sing to, I think we should sing to Lori today. All right, let's sing happy birthday to Lori. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Lori. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Lori. And I have to say, I kind of like this. I can really feel up and close and personal with all of you. This is good. This is good. Let's take this time just to love on each other and meet and greet. this story to you, one that's going to sound familiar, but it has a little different twist to it. 'Twas the night before Jesus came, and all through the place, not a creature was praying, not one on their face. Their Bibles were laying on the shelf without care, in hopes that Jesus would not come there. The children were dressing to crawl into bed, not one ever kneeling or bowing a head. And Mom in her rocker, with Babe on her lap, was watching the late show while I took a nap. When out of the east there arose such a clatter, I sprang to my feet to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters, and threw up the sash. When what to my wondering eyes should appear but angels proclaiming that Jesus was here. With a light like the sun sending forth a bright ray, I knew in a moment this must be the day. The light of his face made me cover my head. It was Jesus returning just like he had said. And though I possessed worldly wisdom and wealth, I cried when I saw him in spite of myself. In the book of life, which he held in his hand, was written the name of every saved man. He spoke not a word as he searched for my name. When he said, "It's not here," my head hung in shame. The people whose names had been written with love, he gathered to take to his Father above. With those who were ready, he rose without a sound, while all the rest were left standing around. I fell to my knees, but it was too late. I had waited too long and thus sealed my fate. I stood and I cried as they rose out of sight. Oh, if only I had been ready tonight. In the words of this poem, the meaning is clear. The coming of Jesus is drawing near. There's only one life, and when comes that last call, we'll find that the Bible was true. After all, Emmanuel has come, and Emmanuel is coming again. Are we ready? Would you pray with me? Father God, as we draw near to our time of communion, Father, we know the sacrifice that you gave for us. And Father, it's such a simple task for us, much too simple, to give our lives back to you and to accept you as our Lord and Savior. And Father, we just thank you for what you did for us, and we thank you that you came as a baby as we celebrate this season. We thank you that you came as that baby only to die as a young man for the forgiveness of our sins, Father. Help us to keep that in mind this year, next year, and the years to come. We thank you, we love you, and we praise your name, Emmanuel, in Jesus' name.
Oh, As we come to our time of communion, let's just remember why we take communion. We take communion to remember what Jesus has done for us. When we couldn't do for ourselves what needed to be done, to have our sins forgiven, to wipe our sins free, Jesus came and died on the cross to wipe that free, so we could spend eternity with him in heaven. So when you take the cup or the bread, remember that's Jesus' body that was broken. And then when we take of the cup, it's his blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. We do this to remember what he has done for us, not just to have a quick little snack and a drink, but to remember what he has done for us. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that we could come today and to gather to worship you as one family, to sing your praises, to remember what Christ did for us, that he died on the cross so our sins could be washed away, that those who believe in him could have eternal life. And Father, I pray that at this time we remember all that and not to take it for granted. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Just remember how we do it in the sanctuary. We'll just go from the outside down the sides and then back to your seats through the middle. Thank you. Today we have the privilege of having Dr. Rick Wright with us from Manhattan Christian College to speak to us today. Met Rick this morning, but we have him here because I didn't think Derek and I would be done deer hunting yet, but we were fortunate to get both our deers. He got his Friday morning, and I got mine Friday night. So we were able to make it back after the girls' game in Hayes. So he's going to be here to speak. So at this time, Rick, come on up, and we'll see.
Good morning. I am so glad to be here. I mean, I just feel like we've known each other for a long time. You know, you guys have got that down to an art. You can walk around this place and feel like, hey, people love you and they like you and they feel like we're old friends. Well, I do feel like I've probably been here 30 years ago. I started at Manhattan Christian College in 1989 as the vice president of student life and dean of students, and became the head men's soccer coach in 91, and taught youth ministry. I taught psychology, sociology. I teach now psychology. I taught New Testament theology classes, jack of all trades, master of okay, all right. So, and you know, if I'm a male, I'm not very good at doing more than one thing at once. But my multitasking wife doesn't happen to be here. She's the quality, I'm the quantity. But I am glad to be here, and you've made me feel right at home. In fact, in the parking lot, I went back out to leave my computer out there, and I was trying to get to this car. I had a white car, and I drove a white car. It happens to be the school car, and I wasn't paying attention. And this, ladies, you can relate to. And I'm trying to put the key in the wrong car. And I don't know that. And fortunately, Don comes up. He's so gracious and says, sir, can I help you? And I'm saying, well, no, I can't. Yeah, you can, because I can't get this. My key's not working in this car. And he says, well, that I don't think, sir. He's very, very kind, very nice. And says, sir, I don't think that's your car, because that was his daughter's car. So I am so grateful to be at this place. Because that's kind of how we are. And Heath, I appreciate you asking me to come. And, you know, I pray for your pastor and keep it up. Keep going. And thank you for letting me be here. So, we're kind of like that car deal. We have the answers, but sometimes we're trying to shove the key in the wrong place. If I had any damage, the college will pay for it. We'll take care of it. But that's how we are. We're trying to do things. We got the answers. But we put them in the wrong place. I'm reminded of the man from Texas who called the church office and said, I'd like to speak to the head hog at the trough. And the secretary says, I beg your pardon? And he says, I'd like to speak to the head hog at the trough. And the secretary goes, well, sir, I think you're speaking about our pastor. So we prefer to have him called pastor or brother or preacher. And he said, I'd like to give $100,000 to the church. She said, just a second, the big pig just walked through the front door. I'm sorry, I might remind you of that, you know, but that's how it goes. God is good, isn't he? It's good to be. It's good to be here. God is good all the time. You know, that's enough of a sermon to just stop right there. Amen? Okay, let's do it. No, just kidding. No, Doug is up here. He's in charge of the time for me, and he said I got to 12:15. He's going to wave his tie. No, listen, if I go too long, we better be having miracles in here, okay? I'll try not to cause any problems there. But, you know, we just don't get it right sometimes. We don't get it, you know, I remember even being at Manhattan Christian College when I was in Triumphant Sound. I wasn't in Triumphant Sound because I could sing. It was a group that went out to sing. We had these banana yellow suits. What in the world? And I remember Larry Winger and I were roommates. He was always forgetting his wallet, so my other roommate and I were always having to pay for him because he'd always forget his wallet. But we were We were in Omaha, Nebraska. We'd stayed at these people's house, and there was a whole string of houses that were all the same. We pulled up to the house, and we went to the wrong house and walked in the front door in these yellow suits. I said, I grabbed Larry. I said, Larry, we're in the wrong house. And I grabbed him and got out of there. You see, sometimes I think we miss the op. We're at the right place at the wrong time. But I think I'm at the right place. I know why here. I'm going to ask you a question. How many of you have sinned in the last week? You worthless. I couldn't have told that from the Sunday school class. Why? We've all sinned. If we're going to get in based upon perfection, I got bad news for us. Are we going to get in based upon that? All of you are pretty good. Wouldn't you say this about each other here? They're a good person. Yeah, they're a good person. We're all good people, but guess what? We are all sinners. And we better admit that, and we better know that, because Jesus came to seek and save the lost. You know, the only thing you need to become a Christian is need. You can't earn your way in. None of us are getting in on how good we are. I'm going to tell you right off the bat, I'm not linear in the way I think. I'll get around to the point eventually. Just hang in there. I got to go to all these places. That's how I think. I'm sorry. And you'll get something in there. Just take that one thing and say, God, that was good. I'll just keep that little piece. We're all sinners. And this is the time of year that I'm so excited of, you know? And there's a verse that's been stuck in my mind. It's been stuck in my mind all week. It's found in Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. And I left every Bible at home, except I have two on all these electronic devices. If not, somebody's going to read it for me. Luke chapter 2 says this. We're familiar with it. This is the Christmas. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I could preach a whole sermon on behold. That means look at it. Focus on it. Behold. Now, you know, somebody tell me if this has ever happened to you. Ladies, I have three grown children and my wife, and then I have four granddaughters, and then I have two brand new, basically over the last 3 years, grandsons. I'm telling you what, it's my role to get those boys in trouble. So the 2.5-year-old, he comes to me and he says, Grandpa, let's go downstairs. That only means I am going to get in trouble. So we go downstairs and he says, Grandpa, where's the Cracker Jacks? Now, some of you don't know what Cracker Jacks, but my grandson does, because you can get them three boxes for $1 at the dollar store. You know that. So I go get him, hide him, and I said, honey, I don't think I got any. He said, Grandpa, I'll look here. He finds them. So he eats the Cracker Jacks, and I have a can of pop. I'm a Coke Zero drinker. It's my drug of choice. I'm sorry. Forgive me. Yes, I know I should drink water. Yes, I know it's bad for me, but at least it has no calories. Okay? It has no calories in it. It's called Coke Zero. The zero means there's no calories in it. I like it. I'm sorry. Okay? And he likes it. So I will do two things that get me in trouble. Me. And I'll tell him, don't tell mama or grandma. Don't tell mama or grandma. He eats the Cracker Jacks and drinks the pop. Rarely he gets to drink the pop. It's not killing him, ladies. And then what's he do? He goes upstairs and tells the mama and the grandma what we've done. Who gets in trouble? I'm telling you what. The other night, the 2.5-year-old, you guys, I'm sorry about these stories, but the 2.5-year-old, he gets up in the middle of the night, starts yelling for mommy. And the 2.5-year-old, this is how they yell for mommy. Mommy! Mommy! And he wants somebody, and they've taken the side of his crib down so he could get up and get out of there and go in there, but he doesn't because he's been taught to stay in the bed. He's going, Mommy, and then he starts, Daddy. Then he starts, Grandma. Finally, he says, anybody. Anybody out there. You know, and I like that because sometimes people right now are looking for things. They're looking for things. There was a young man by the name of Ricky Wiseman from Garden City. He was from London, England. and he played goalie in Garden City. How far is Garden City from here? What? About an hour, man. I knew somebody from Garden City about 5-6 years ago. The guy comes into my office, and he says, he comes to my office, and from Garden City, I'm the soccer coach, and he comes there, and he says, he came to ask about soccer. And I said, well, we're a Christian college, and do you know anything about that? And he said, no, I never went to any kind of church, or I never went to anything. I said, well, are you willing to learn? This is a guy, last name is Ricky Wiseman. Now, where have we heard that last name from? W-I-S-E-M-A-N. Or M-E-N, I can't remember which. But where have we heard it from? In the Christmas story, the wise men went to, who were they looking for? They were looking for Jesus. And I have a divine appointment. A guy from Garden City who'd never been to church in his life, didn't know anything about it. Wiseman, a great goalie from London, England, with an English accent, comes into my office. Now, who do you think set that up? There's no doubt in my mind that that was set up by God himself. Long before, I said, what are you doing here? He said, I have a girlfriend who's going to Kansas State University. I'm thinking, well, that won't last long, you know. one thing I tell, I'm the head men's soccer coach. This is the advice I give the young men I have. This will tell you what kind of guys they are. I tell them it will last a lot longer if you do not, under any circumstance, let them get to know you. And they think I'm giving them a compliment. All right? He comes into my office. He sits down there, he tells me about his girlfriend, and I said, well, he wanted to come play soccer. I said, well, soccer I use as a leverage. So I'm a youth minister following the footsteps of Heath, but I've been a youth minister all my life. I don't care what color my hair is. I got 2 junior high kids inside of me, okay? I haven't grown up yet. I'm running out of time, but this guy comes in there, and God has got this all set up, and finally I just say, well, if you want to learn about Jesus, we'll let you in. So we let that guy in, shared the gospel with him. I shared the gospel with him. Gospel, and this is what the sermon is about, and it's perfect for this time of the year, and it's perfect for what happens in Luke, and then I'm going to jump to verse 15, and then I'm going to go all over the place. Okay? It's the gospel. I shared the gospel with him. I have these divine appointments. I had another kid from Trinidad and Tobago. Long story, but he gets to Manhattan Christian College. The national office set up for us to help him. I said, okay, we'll help him. We didn't know him from Adam. I didn't even know where Trinidad and Tobago was. It's in the Caribbean. 6'3", black man. Big guy. He came there, and I remember sharing the gospel with him on my dirty pickup truck in Kmart's parking lot in Manhattan, Kansas. I drew the bridge illustration out there. Got to the end and asked him if he wanted to accept Christ and be baptized. Guess what he said? He said yes. So God set that whole thing up from Trinidad and Tobago to the national office, all over the place, and then he ends up in my office. He ends up with me in the parking lot of my dirty truck, my dirty F-150, out there in the parking lot of Kmart, and shared the gospel with him. And we baptized him in the ocean, because we went to the national tournament, we baptized him in the ocean. That water was closer to Trinidad and Tobago. Now, who set that up? That was the good news. That was the gospel. Gospel comes from the Greek word, two words, euangelion. Ou means good. And angelion is where we get the word angel, the one who sent, and it's good news. It's good news. And I'm telling you something this morning. My message simply is this. We need, as Christians, the good news every day. That's why I started asking you whether you've sinned this week. You have sinned this week. We don't get in. We're not good enough to get in based upon anything else than the good news. And I'm going to talk about it. Isn't that what the angel said in this passage? What does the angel say? Listen to what he says here. He says, and the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you what? Good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Good news of great joy. You know, I think we get this word good news all messed up. It doesn't say good list of 150,000 things to do. Okay? You know, if I get three things to do, 50 weeks a year, I'll take two off where I was sick for church. Then I get 150 things to do. Now, I'm sure all those things are good, but I can't do the Ten Commandments. And if I don't have it balanced out, then I'm going to miss the boat. We're going to miss the boat. I can't do it. It's no wonder we don't have joy. What in the phrase of good news is there that says something we are supposed to do? The good news is for Christians every day. What in the good news is something we are supposed to do? Doesn't say anything there. It just says, I'm bringing you good news of great joy. I want that good news, and I want that good news today, and I want to share that good news today. Now, I if I wander all over the place, that's fine, walking around. But I'm a person who likes Coke Zero. Does anybody else in here like Coke Zero? What? I'm sorry. I'm stuck in a college town. I'm a late-night person, so I can't go to bed until 1 o'clock in the morning. And I'm reading. I can't do it. I'm just stuck on college time, which is 4 hours off of what normal people do. Okay? And I like, in the morning for breakfast, what do you think I like to drink? Not coffee. You called it what? Coke Zero is my drug of choice. Coke Zero. How many like coffee? Raise your hand. Oh, look at that. That's pretty good. That's my coffee. There's caffeine in it. Give me a break, okay? But how many think that that's bad for me? Raise your hand. Okay, that's right. You're going to tell me. Okay, you can say a bottle of water. Okay, how many like tea? What is it you like? Usually people like coffee. I like a Coke Zero. So if I came to you, now think about this. If I came to you and asked you, would you buy me a Coke Zero? Now, you don't have to today. I have two in the car that would still be cold. I have two in the car. Okay, if I came to you and asked you, oh, would you buy me a Coke Zero? Raise your hand if you'd say yes. Okay, some did it, some wouldn't. Most of you would. Thank you. Okay, well, what about the next day I came to you and saw you again, and I asked you that day, would you buy me a Coke Zero today? What would you do on the second day? Raise your hand. Okay, fewer hands. Okay, what if I did that the third day, or the fourth day, or the fifth day? I'll tell you what you'd do on the fifth day as a good Christian. This is what you'd say in your mind. Buy your own pop, pig. But you would think it, but you wouldn't say it because you're a good Christian. Buy your own pop, pig. Okay? But let me change this slightly. What about if I put $1 million in your bank account every day? You would do more than that. You'd pay somebody $50,000 a year to follow me around in a pop truck. I can't even say it, pop truck with spigots on the side giving out cold Coke Zero, wouldn't you? You pay $100,000 for the, $80,000 for the truck and $50,000 for somebody driving. Why? Why would you do that and not bat an eye? Who said that? Sherlock Holmes right here. You got the right answer because you're not going to be able to outgive God on it. If somebody's giving you $1 million a day, you can't outgive them. So then what would you say on the 15th day if I came? Would you ever say, buy your own pop, pig? No. It'd be ridiculous, wouldn't it? All right, now let me give you this verse. Lamentations 3, 22 and 23 says this. What does it say? Lamentations 3, 22 and 23. I think it says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions, what? They are new every morning. Can you outgive God? We're looking. I remember this is an old movie. I'm sorry about it. The Indiana Jones, the very first one. I think it's the first one. And Bella, one of the two guys, is sitting with Indiana Jones. And they're sitting in the restaurant. And the Germans are going to, they're digging for the relic. I can't remember what it was. It was the Ark of the Covenant. They were digging. But they didn't get the directions right. And when they realized that, they looked at each other and said this. Anybody know what they said? They're digging in the wrong place. They had the answer, but they weren't digging in the right place. That's us. We're digging in the wrong place. You see, we need to have our thoughts adjusted. It's like the whole book of Romans. There's one word in Romans that is electrifying to me, and it's the very first word of Romans chapter 12, verse 1. And what is that word in Romans 12, 1? One word turns the whole thing upside down. What does it say in that one word? Therefore is the most important word in the book of Romans. Therefore, and it doesn't start until the 12th chapter. And then it says this. Therefore, you know what the word therefore is therefore? What does it mean? It means something before it happened. We always want to skip to what we do. And when we skip to what we do without what God has done, we can't do it. It can't be done what we need to do unless God is working in our lives to do it. Pure and simple. And that therefore is right there in Romans 12, 1, because all of the first 11 chapters are about the gospel. They're about what God has done. They're about what God does consistently for us every day. That's why Paul says in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. First the Jew and then the Gentile. And 17 says something else. Here's why. Because in the gospel, what? A righteousness, what? Somebody got it here? A righteousness is revealed from God. Whose righteousness is it? It's surely not ours. We've been to church every week for the last, most of us have been here. I'll assume all of you have been there. I came in, you asked, how many of you have sinned? That's why we can't judge each other, because we are all sinners. And the only way in is because of what Christ has done. We only get into heaven because someone is perfect. That's the only way to get into heaven. And Christ is the one that's perfect. Now, how does all this relate together? Let me go back to this truck illustration. Jesus, the first 11 chapters tell everything that Jesus has done. And then we finally get to what we're supposed to do with the therefore. We always want to skip to what we want to do. We always want to tell everybody what to do, and we forget the fact that God is so good to us. But then it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, therefore I urge you in view of what? He doesn't urge us to do 50,000 things. Do this thing three times. Do this one new three times next week. Do. He gets the order right. He says, I urge you in view of God's mercy to offer yourself, your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. Then he gets at what we do always flows out of what God has done. If it doesn't, we can't do it. It's too hard to do. I have to have the good news every day. I'm grateful for the good news every day. I need to be reminded of the gospel. Now, if you have your Bibles, let's switch to 1 Corinthians 15. It says this in 1 Corinthians 15. Corinthians, they were kind of like all of us at times. There were a lot of people messed up in the book of Corinthians. There was a lot of sins going on there. You can go back and read the first 15 chapters. People were messed up. So a lot of times people say they want to be a New Testament Christian church. Well, not this one. I mean, there's a lot of bad things. We need to be better than that. But here's what it says in 1 Corinthians 15. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the... In the 15th chapter, he wants to remind them of what? Of the gospel. Now, I don't know if you have anybody at your house who always loses something. I lose my Sunday school, sunglasses, and ask my wife, where are they? And she says, they're on your head. And raise your hand if that's ever happened to you or done that to somebody. Okay? Some of us need to be reminded. How many have someone that needs to be reminded? Raise your hand and look at that person. No, just raise your hand. We need to be reminded. I'm reminding you today, this is what we need to be reminded of. And this is Christmas, and it's about the gospel. That's why I like Christmas, but we should have Christmas almost every day all year long. Because it's good news. It's news. And when it's news, it's something that happened to somebody else. They're bringing news. They're not bringing me a list of 5,000 things to do. If they do it that way, I can't do it. If we just go to the Bible and talk about all of it, now don't get me wrong here. I'm not saying we don't need those other things. I'm just saying there better be a balance about what God has done. Because if I don't have the mercies and the balance, then I'm not going to be able to do the other. In fact, if I only have half, I don't want to go to church because they're just going to tell me what to do. I don't want it. I've heard enough. I've heard it my whole life. I don't want to hear it. But I need to hear about God's mercy is new every day. I need to hear about the good. It's good news. It's euangelion, and that's what happens right off the first Christmas is I bring you good news of great joy for who? It's for everybody. Now, they may not receive it, but 1 Corinthians 15 tells us what to do. And I'm sorry that I'm not going point by point by point because I'm just going by time. And I got more time because the tie hasn't gone up. Okay? All right? 1 Corinthians 15. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preach to you, which you have received, in which you stand. He's got to remind them of this point because he's pointed out a lot of times. And he goes back and he makes it very clear what the most important thing is. By which you are saved, hold fast to the word I preached to you unless you believed in me. And then verse 3. For I delivered to you as of first importance. I know you've heard this. The main thing is to keep the main thing. What? I can't remember where it came from, but somebody can tell me where it came from. It'll come to me in a minute. But the main thing is to keep the main thing, the main thing. And what's the main thing for us? Is it what we do? There's a lot of things we do. Can anybody be here be good enough by your actions to get into heaven? Not in my Bible. Not in my Bible. It's what Jesus has done. It's what God is doing. That's called worship. You know what worship means? Worship, the word means ascribing ultimate value. Okay? Who worships? Everybody that I know on the face of this earth worships because they ascribe ultimate value. Now, they may ascribe ultimate value to the wrong thing, but they worship. Some people ascribe ultimate value to what? Give me some examples to what people ascribe to. Ascribe ultimate value to what? Work. They ascribe ultimate value to work. What else? What? Possessions. What else? What? Power. What else? I don't even need to be here today. I can be done right now. You know these things. These can't, and even our families, if they go first, it causes problems. Ascribe ultimate value because in each of us is a hole that's made, and the only thing that can fill that is God Himself, and anything else is not going to work. I don't even have to prove it to you. Put those other things in place and see if they crumble. Put somebody in the place of our transcendent God as a friend and expect them to live up to what God has done. They can't do it. Those things can't do it. The only person and being that can do it is God. And guess what? We have the good news that God comes to us. Good news. Not good list of works. I'm not going to sit here for the next year and tell you three things unless it's balanced out with how great God is. I got to have how great He is. I can't do it. So here are some things I want you to remember about the gospel. I've already started to talk about them, but I'm going to give you seven things. No, that's not 7 hours of speaking. Stay calm, because I've already gone over some. Here we go. First one is this, and I already mentioned it. Christians are forgetful. I need to be reminded daily of what the gospel is. And this guy in 1 Corinthians, Paul, he does remind us. What is the gospel? Here's the gospel. And this is what I share with these guys. For I delivered unto you as of first importance what I also received, that Jesus, and we heard this during communion. Heath, you shared this. That Jesus, and that in accord, Christ died for our sins in accordance with Scriptures. He was buried, and He was raised on the third day in accordance with Scriptures, and that He appeared to Peter, and then to the 12, and then He appeared to over 500 people. That's the good news. Christ died on the cross for my sins. Now, how do I get in? Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, then I no longer live, but the life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I get in based upon what Jesus has done. He died for my sins, but also what did he do? He lived the perfect life. His obedience is credited to me. Justification means just as if I'd never sinned. Justification. I am justified. I'm declared righteous. How am I declared righteous? By what Jesus has done. And Jesus died on the cross for my sins, but he paid the punishment for all those sins. But also on that, he ascribed to my account his righteousness. That's how I get in. And where does that come about? By faith. I have to trust him. Now, I'm telling you the greatest news there is. That's the gospel. And if you're here this morning and you say, well, I haven't lived a good life, well, then you're at the right place. Tell me what. Who's the good news for? You got it. It's good for everybody here. All of us. That's what the angel said. I bring you good news, a great joy that will be for all people. It's for everyone if they accept it. We need to be reminded. I need to be reminded daily, so don't blow it. Secondly, it's good news. I've already talked about it. That's good news. And how is it good news? It's good news because somebody else did it. And sometimes I think, well, I'm saved as a Christian. That's good news. And then I have to flog myself my whole life to be doing better. No, that doesn't work that way. Go back to my illustration on the truck. You want to be. Do I have to beg you to thank me for giving you $1 million a day for the rest of your life? What are you going to do? What are you going to say to me when you see me? You're going to thank me for what? You're going to thank me every day, and you're going to want to do anything I ask, correct? And it's because God has done so much. That simple illustration helps us understand. God's mercies are new every day. If you're here and you need mercies, you can have it. If you're here and you need good news, I'm telling you what, it's the best present that I can give you right now. Today or the 4th of July, you can open that Christmas present. You can receive it. You can believe it and receive it. But it must be received. It must be preached, is it proclaimed? That's what we're doing. We need to share it with people. Ricky Wiseman became a Christian because I shared it with him. Serginho Sandy from Trinidad and Tobago heard it and received it. He had to take it. He had to receive it. If this is $100 and I'm willing to give it to you, when do you have it? When you take it, when you receive it. There was a man, Mark Jackson, I was in the youth ministry in Wichita before I went to Manhattan Christian College. A policeman. He wasn't dressed as a policeman. He came in and he wanted to talk to somebody who's really struggling with something. Well, I'm the youth minister, and this is a man coming in. Well, I talked to him, and then I tried to pass him on to who? I tried to pass him on to the associate. I tried to pass him on to the senior minister. But guess what happened? I had to talk to him, and I shared the gospel with him. I shared the good news with him, and it was such good news for him. What did he do? He received it. He took it. And then he helped me out. Divine appointment. Divine appointment. We run into those people all the time. We run into them. We share the gospel with them. Divine appointment. I don't have to do much. My wife always says to me, did you know that person? I said, yeah, I knew. We're good friends from about 20 seconds ago. There were some college students down in Aggieville, which is right by the college. About 10 years ago, they were all dressed in black. And I went down there, and I just said, Marta and I were, there used to be a theater in Aggie. I said, come on, Marta, it's before. My poor wife, I drug her out, and we went down there. I said, I got to go talk to these guys. So I walk out there, and I'm talking to all these young people who are all dressed in black. Their friends drive by. Who's that guy? They don't know, but I said, one of them I asked, she had her hair like this, and I asked, well, what does your mom think about that? And that was when rings were coming about and stuff like that, which was all right with me. I said, what'd she say about that? And she says, well, she doesn't know if I hold my head like this. And the other kid, he had a foot-long purple mohawk. I want to talk to him. I was not afraid to talk to him. How many times you get a chance to talk to somebody who's got a foot-long mohawk? Twice I have. Once I got a picture with him, and they were both down in Aggieville. I said, I asked him, well, what does your parents think about that? Just out of curiosity. And you know what he said? I don't have any parents. And you know what I thought? How are they going to know if what? We're so easy to judge people, but how are they going to know unless they what? They're not going to know unless somebody hears it, somebody tells them. And you know what? A fat old man like me is not going to be able to walk up to anybody, although I'll try. But all of us as a group together can walk up to whoever comes up to us and not be ashamed of what we got if we realize what we have. We don't realize what we have. We don't realize what good news it is. We don't realize how good the news is. I got to receive it. I got to preach it. And then I got to realize it is the most important thing. It's unchanging. And the gospel is about Jesus Christ. There was I know you know about this, some of you do. In West Texas, there was a famous oil field known as Yates Pool. During the Depression, the field was a sheep ranch owned by a man named Ira Yates. Who knows Ira Yates? Who's heard about Ira Yates? I can just make this up then. I'll check it out online. Ira Yates. He was not able to make enough money on his ranching operation to pay the principal and interest on the mortgage, so he was in danger of losing his ranch. With little money for clothes and food, his family, like many others, had to live on government subsidy. Day after day, as he grazed his sheep, he wondered how he would be able to pay his bills. Then a seismograph crew from an oil company came into the area and told Mr. Yates that there might be oil on his land. They asked permission to drill a wildcat well, and he signed a lease contract. At 1,115 feet, they struck a huge oil reserve. The well came in at 80,000 barrels a day. Many later wells were more than twice that. 30 years after the first well was drilled, all the wells still only had the potential of pumping 125,000 barrels of oil, and Mr. Yates owned it all. That he was living on government assistance, a multimillionaire living in poverty. What's the problem? He did not know the oil was there. He owned it, but he did not know it. This is part of the problem we have as Christians. We have abundant wealth. Now to him who is able to do all that we can imagine. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. We have abundant wealth because we are in Christ. We don't know what we have. Jesus Christ came so that you and I might have life full and meaningful, yet many people are not aware of all that is theirs, even though it's right at their fingertips. John said this in 10:10, I come that they may have life, and they may have it abundantly. Don't just sit there. Believe it and live it. My offering to you, I offer to you the good news. And the good news is for you. And the good news is that Christ died for us and wiped out all of our sins and punished for it. Not only that, he lived a perfect life, and I trust his righteousness. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew and then the Gentile. Because in it, the righteousness of God is revealed. And it's only by Christ's righteousness do we make it in. I know where my dad's at. I know where my brother's at. They trusted in Christ. I know where they're at. I know where I'm going. You can know where you're going. I'm going to trust in the good news. I'm going to trust in the good news. It's a little bit like this. There was a little girl was talking to her teacher about whales and how she heard in Sunday school about how a whale swallowed Jonah. The teacher said it was physically impossible for a whale to swallow a human being because even though it was a very large mammal, its throat was very small. The little girl remained steadfast in her position and reiterated that indeed a whale had swallowed Jonah. Irritated, the teacher again stated that a whale could not swallow a human. It was physically impossible. The little girl said, I'm not sure how it happened, but when I get to heaven, I will ask Jesus. The teacher replied smugly, well, what if Jonah isn't in heaven? The little girl replied, then you can ask him. We are going to trust in Jesus. I trust in his righteousness. I trust in his mercy. I trust in his goodness. I trust he gave me the ticket to heaven. I trust that I get in. Not trust, I know and trust. I get in because of what he's done. Therefore, in view of all God's mercy, I'm going to work as hard as I possibly can for him. You see, our obedience flows from God's grace and mercy. Last passage for you, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved. Past tense, completed action. You're saved by grace, not by works, so that no one can boast. Now that sounds like works are not important, but that's only 8 and 9. Verse 10 says this. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to what? To do good works. We don't do good works in order to be saved. We're saved in order to what? Do good works. Pours out his mercy. Now, is that good news? And that's good news what? I want to tell you this. It's good news every day. And did I need to bring that to you as a reminder? Yes, I did. Merry Christmas. And just because I had the key and didn't get it in the right spot, Don was out there, and finally I didn't ruin the car. He helped me put it. He had to come out. He was very gracious, came up and told me. You know how many people you walk around that are trying to put things in the wrong spot? Daily they're walking around, and you know who has the answer for about where it could be? You tell me. Don does. No, don't just excuse it to Don. Everybody does. Hey, let me ask you this. I got to stop. I said I'd be done by 11:45. I got 3 minutes. You guys, I love you. In the words of the famous theologian Homer Simpson, share the wealth. Share the wealth. It's good news. It's good news. It's not a good list of 7,000 things to do. Should you not lie? And all those things, yes, you shouldn't do them. But we are saved in order to obey. And if we get the order out, we'll just make everybody sick. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I praise you for my newfound brothers and sisters. I know this is a divine appointment. I know you're good. Thank you for your good news. Thank you that as we celebrate Christmas, that we celebrate Christmas, your angel said, I bring you good news of great joy. Thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Would you stand for our hymn of invitation?
You know, when you have to do something different, you kind of forget what you're supposed to do all the time. But that's kind of the way the thing this morning has gone. But it's good. It's good for some change. I think sometimes when we do church in the sanctuary all the time, we just get used to it all the time. So it's been nice being able to meet in here, to hear somebody different, or at least for me, hear somebody different speak. Thank you, Mr. Wright, for coming and all that. But for us to be able to be in here, we also, there was a lot of work that was done. And I know there were some people who came in and helped set some chairs up. But last night, Israel and Jonathan spent hours getting the sound ready for us to do this, and then for those of our family who can't be here to join us online too. So when you see Israel and Jonathan, make sure you say thank you, because I mean it was after midnight for some to get to before they were able to be done. So just so we can be here, and I think there's a good chance we'll probably be in here again next Sunday. So just to let you know ahead of time. So, but anyway. Tell them thanks. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer, and then you will be dismissed. Father, I thank you for being our God, for loving us enough to send your son Jesus here to earth to live a perfect life, to die on the cross, to be buried, and then you raise him again 3 days later. And Father, I just thank you that you have shared that good news with us. And that you've given us the opportunity as your children, as your ambassadors, to share the good news with others, with those that are around us. And Father, pray that we'll do that, because we have great news. We have the greatest news that there ever was, and we need to be willing to share it. And Father, I pray that you'll give us the words to say when it's time. And Father, I pray you'll give us just help us to care enough about others like you love us. Help us to love others enough to share that good news with them so they can find you and come to you for forgiveness and to have salvation too. And Father, thank you for each one here and their love for you. And be with us as we go out and about, and help us just take the good news wherever we go. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
much to be thankful for. It's Christmas. Oh, how I miss this. But through the joy and laughter, you can feel the sadness. 'Cause this Christmas, everyone's not